Warm greetings. My name is Anil Ganesh and I'm a graduate student at Dalhousie University under the supervision of Dr. Rita Orji. Today I'll be presenting my Kai late-breaking work titled Permarun, a persuasive game to improve user awareness and self-efficacy towards secure smartphone behavior. Research on cybersecurity has been around for a long time, but the late realization of users being targeted has led to ponder about user awareness and usable security. Seldom work has been done on creating contextual games to raise user awareness around smartphone security. Researchers have shown that awareness among users is low and most of the users do not follow secure smartphone behavior. We refer to the general etiquettes that can be followed to use a smartphone safely as secure smartphone behavior. For example, installing an antivirus or using a VPN to connect to a public network are some of the secure smartphone behaviors. Existing interventions point out to the causes and effects of permissions, but they do not educate the user why a specific permission might be necessary for an app. In our game, we include a contextual story that involves Android permissions. We operationalize Android permissions as in-game collectible objects. In a single level, the player collects permissions for a specific app. For example, if the app is an online music player, the player must collect appropriate permissions according to the app features mentioned before the start of a level. We implemented 9 persuasive strategies from the framework for persuasive system design by Oinas Kukkonen and 6 game design patterns as collated by Khalifa and others. We'll be looking at some of the key persuasive strategy implementations and game design patterns. A system that helps the user to observe the link between causes and effects is called simulation. In our game, the unnecessary permissions are colored in red and the necessary permissions are colored in green. When the user picks up red permissions, their score decreases and their movement speed is reduced for a short period. When they pick up a green permission, their score increases. This way, we create a positive and negative feedback loop for the player. A system that helps the user to keep track of their performance can be classified as self-monitoring. In our game, we present the user with a heads-up display at the bottom of the screen that displays the permissions that are to be collected throughout a level. Providing appropriate suggestions when the user is using the app is classified as suggestion strategy. In our game, we show secure smartphone behavior tips as suggestions when the user picks up necessary or unnecessary permission. Rewarding the user for performing a specific task is classified as reward strategy. We reward the user with in-game points when they pick up necessary permissions, and we also have hidden areas in-game with rewards such as extra health and extra life that the player can collect. We also rank the players against each other on a leaderboard. This is classified as competition strategy. We implemented 6 game design patterns as collated by Khalifa and others. These patterns are to make the game more interesting to play. Foreshadowing is a design technique where the player is teased with in-game objects that cannot be accessed directly. Here in the image, we can see that the character is standing right above an extra life that cannot be reached directly. Using non-verbal and visual cue to guide the user is classified as guidance design pattern. Here the leaves and the gap beneath the player give a visual cue for the further exploration. Pace breaking is the process of increasing and decreasing the in-game tension. This is usually achieved by introducing enemies and obstacles. Here we can see that the player is safe on top of a platform, but the game tension would increase as they proceed forward. We performed heuristic evaluation for playability and persuasiveness evaluation with the help of 6 persuasive researchers. The heuristic evaluation for playability is used to evaluate the game design and identify any issues during the prototyping stage. Each of the 4 heuristics shown here has subscales to identify common issues. For measuring the persuasiveness, we used a 5-point Likert scale to collect the opinions of evaluators for each implementation of the persuasive strategy. The game mechanics was rated the highest and the game score the lowest, but it was still above the neutral score of 3. Liking a selection strategy scored the highest and praise scored the lowest. This might be because we had only one instance of praise towards the end of the game. Overall, the evaluators found the game to be enjoyable. Some of the evaluators felt nostalgic while playing the game and stated it was similar to Super Mario and Dadish, while some suggested pausing the game while displaying suggestions. Some of them found the game to be a bit challenging, but they reported feeling good after finishing the game. Designing retro games that are relatable to the user reduces their learning curve and attracts a wide variety of audience. Existing research shows that challenging retro games are not only nostalgic but also gives the player a satisfaction of competence. Our design decision to make the game resemble well-known retro games eventually paid off. For our future work, we plan to rework the game design and introduce adaptive difficulty, and we also plan to include other smartphone security issues. This is a list of references for this presentation. Thank you for your time.